So we've been sending up ever more satellites since the advent several years ago of satellite internet services, obviously with Starlink being the pretty far ahead of all the others. And we've all read stories over the years of like space junk, and there's so much stuff that we've sent into orbit that there's increasing concern that something might hit something else, and then you'll have screws flying around at 20,000 miles an hour, and nobody wants that. So knowing that all these satellites were going up, they were built according to what's called a design for demise strategy. Basically, at the end of the...
Kind of like a planned obsolescence in space?
100%.
Yeah.
And like these things last like 5 years, and so they deorbit them, and they just let the atmosphere burn them up. And the thing, the funny thing about burning something up is like you don't get rid of the particles that make it up. So all those particles that used to be in the satellite are just going to become a part of the atmosphere. And that's kind of been fine in over the decades as we've deorbited things and burned them up the atmosphere. But given the projections of how many satellites are going to go up and how many are going to have to come out of orbit every day, they're looking at a seeding of the top of the atmosphere with a number of substances that could lead to further deterioration of the ozone layer, which is this gaseous layer that hangs in the stratosphere and protects living things from the sun's ultraviolet rays.
Basically, we're allowed to live, right? Survive, because we have the ozone layer.
Yeah.
It's a little important.
It's pretty important. And so there's and the neat thing about the science that is coming out now is like it's not a problem yet. Mm-hmm. Like one thing that I think is overlooked a lot about some of these like big systemic planetary problems is like even though they're like they seem huge and unmanageable to us, like, you know, a big rock in space with like atmosphere around it is kind of easy to model for the physicists. And so they've gotten pretty good over the last 50 to 100 years of saying, hey, if we keep adding these materials, like this is probably going to happen. So we're getting the alert just when we need it most and just when the industry and governments can decide how they want to cope with the issue.
So, Sana, let's bring you in here. Maybe you could just describe to us what actually happens. There's a satellite, you know, it's deconstructing, I guess we could call it, and it's falling from the sky. Like, what is going on with the satellite itself and then in the atmosphere when this is taking place?
Yeah, so they're basically the satellites, when they are deorbited at the end of their lifespan, they basically disintegrate upon reentry. So the atmosphere kind of pulls them in and they burn up in the fiery atmosphere and they release materials like aluminum and other metals. And that, as Eric mentioned, it can potentially alter the chemical composition of the upper atmosphere. And it could also, you know, deplete the ozone layer. And as Eric mentioned, you know, that the research is still, it's still new, it's still burgeoning, but that is what scientists are saying. And you know, it's especially important because this issue is only supposed to get more extreme as the number of satellites are expected to project. So right now, the amount of satellites in the in orbit have basically followed like a hockey puck trend. So they keep every single year, there's been like the past 5 or 6 years, there's been a record number of satellites going up. And, you know, there's some projections that there's, you know, around 12,000 today, and that could go up to between nearly 60,000 to 100,000 in about 5 years.
That's nuts.
Exactly. So with that, all those satellites have to come down at some point. So that's why, you know, the alarm bell is so important right now, because we have the opportunity to kind of help, you know, make regulation, mitigate those impacts before maybe it becomes too late.
Oh, that sounds so sweet. I just want to throw in numbers. You guys have great stats in here. By 2035, Goldman Sachs projects the value of the satellite industry will reach $108 billion, up from $15 billion. I'm being fun with you in terms of regulation, because I'm just wondering, it sounds like, Eric, somebody, the government, like somebody needs to be watching and saying, we got to deal with this, potentially.
You know, and ironically, the government's decision that these things should sunset after 5 years was a part of looking at the situation and forward thinking. But You know, there's just no free lunch. So yeah. Any policy decision is...
Do they have to have them sunset after 5 years?
Well, they'll stop working.
They just stop
at a certain point. And so like you don't want stuff flying around. I mean, one of the things they're looking at, that engineers are looking at in terms of the making these things themselves, is are there other materials they can make it out of? You know, things that may not seed the atmosphere with these particular chemicals.
Sana, talk to us about the observed environmental impacts that we've seen so far. I know in the piece you guys mentioned soot, and I'm wondering, you know, scientists have observed these effects, but do we understand yet whether these are necessarily bad or not?
Yeah, so it is an early field of research, but it has been seen that that like kerosene, which used to power many launches. So this is now talking about when the rockets are bringing the satellites into orbit. That was powered by kerosene, which could lead to soot pollution. So that is, you know, a chronicled effect. And so when that soot is, you know, at loftier heights, like it's in the atmosphere, it absorbs heat and it accelerates glacial melt. So that is one impact that we know is happening, but that's more associated with launches than with satellite reentries. With satellite reentries, it's a little bit more uncertain. They definitely have, there's been a good amount of research that says that these particles have the, especially the ones that are like aluminum and alumina ones, have the ability to you know, affect the ozone layer, but yeah, those are still being studied. And there's definitely like a lot more research that needs to be done to understand how is, you know, the best way for satellite companies to think about this, the best way for governments to think about this, industry. Yeah.
You know, it's interesting because you guys include in this too about what happened with jet fuel, right? And the impact on the ozone, and certainly companies, the industries came together. And I want to put this out to both of you. Son, I'll go to you first and then Eric, maybe come on in. Is just, I mean, is regulation even an option when you have someone like Elon Musk around the White House trying to get SpaceX contracts, you know, guilty? I've got, you know, one of his discs. I can't even think of what it's called.
Starlink.
Thank you very much. Like I understand it works really well, the value. But I'm just curious, is it even an option with Elon Musk? And Sana, if you have some thoughts on that, then I'd love Eric for you to address as well.
Yeah, totally. I mean, it's hard. I feel like this is not, you know, what's on top of mind for people in the government and especially satellite companies. And like the people that think about this regulation, which is the FCC, the FCC makes the regulations for space companies. The space bureau chief of the FCC said that we can, you know, manage this without regulation and we can be sustainable in space without regulation. But it's also like, it's confusing how exactly that would happen without regulation. And so I think that when you have an administration that is so enthusiastic about reaching the commercial heights of space and low Earth orbit, it's definitely feels more difficult than maybe it could have been in the past or in another administration.
Right.
And also, like, we spoke to several companies and, you know, they are going to keep operating the way they do unless someone tells them, you know, that there's new regulation, you have to do that. So I think it will really have to start at the top. But as you said, I think it's a little bit difficult to see that really happening in today.
Eric, come on in, because you guys even talk about, I think someone talking about, you know, we need some research a little bit more, right? And we know research has been cut back in a big way in the government.
Yeah, you can't just roll out of bed and collect data from the top of the stratosphere. And there's some data that's come in over the years from launches to see what's in the wake of rocket launches, but this is they need a new program. There was a good study in 2023 that came out. One of the first things to put this on the map. They flew NASA stratospheric, you know, high flying airplanes, mm-hmm. Collected some materials from up there, and they found that like already 10% of the stratospheric aerosols have aluminum in it from re-entered satellites,
So I don't know. I hate to leave people with like.
Well, there's a good, you know, we have a strong history of dealing with the ozone layer. You know, there was a huge problem in the mid 80s. All the countries got together, decided they were going to fix it, and they did.
Yeah.